you to Africa.
Yeah. Hi, Ali. What took you to Africa?
Because I took a permaculture course in 1984, and for want of a better definition, I'm a first-generation permaculture missionary.
So after you took the course, I understood that Bill asked you the big question, what are you going to do with this course? And you kind of answered him.
Yes, I said I was going to do permaculture for the rest of my life because I had hit a dead end in my life, quite frankly. And when I took my course, everything changed. All of a sudden, I saw nothing but solutions. And so I asked Bill, where should I go? And he pondered, thought about it, and then he said, well, we don't have anyone in South America. We've got people in Africa, we've got people in Asia, but there's no one there. Why don't you go there? So I thought about it, and I thought, well, great idea, but that I'll go there. And so I spent the next 27 years in the Amazon. And then when Bill returned in to visit the projects in 2007, he said, enough's enough, it's time to move on. And so I went to Africa. He said Africa is the place to go. He wanted information on how to turn around a resource-poor African community, rural community with all the problems of the world, what it would cost, how much time, what kind of skills. And so I spent several months touring Africa, and eventually it seemed logical to start off in Mozambique. So I'm working in a rural African village, which is a classic dollar a day, less than a dollar a day, with high incidences of HIV and tuberculosis. It's a settled post-Civil War community. There is no potable groundwater, etc., etc. It was perfect for giving a permaculture a shot. And so that's where I am. I've been there now 6 years.
Yeah. And what steps did you do when you arrived at the country? I knew you went to the capital to start with, because, and then decided to go south after that.
Yeah. Well, because of a contact, started work in this community that I mentioned, that's a dollar a day, less than a dollar a day. And I did what I had done for the last 30 years of my life. I concentrated on establishing a permaculture demonstration center as a reference point, because it's pointless talking to third world people about what could be or what might be or how it could change if you don't actually point your finger at what it is you're wanting to do. So we built the center, classrooms, storage facilities, gathering room, then the gardens, and then of course there was the issue of food and water security. There was no potable water, so we had to do a massive infrastructure development program to capture every single drop of available rainwater. And from there we grew the food, and we could begin a program to feed all the orphans from the HIV epidemic.
Yeah. Right. So your experience, like Margie and I visited your centers in Brazil. So I understood, you know, when you talked to us in Brazil, you talked about that you had one in each kind of climatic zone.
Yeah.
And that you developed these amazing centers, and you were able to do that really, as you said, a lot quicker.
Yeah.
And Mozambique has really been a challenge for you, because you could you explain more why?
Yeah, Brazil was the lap of luxury ecologically. It spoiled it for me. And Mozambique, the area I mean, Mozambique has a longer coastline, six times longer than California. So in the north, it's lush tropical rainforest. And in the south, it's a very dry, arid tropics, subtropics. And the issue is water. And as we don't have any potable groundwater, everything is dependent on rainfall and what it is you can capture from storage. And so we had to build ponds, fish ponds, storage ponds, flood water capture systems, whatever it was that we could do to capture water in the landscape. And from there, grew the food that was required. It's very difficult because things grow. I've been doing tropical food forests for 30 years. That's all I did in and out of those years. In Africa, it's a very slow process to do that. So I've concentrated on vegetables as just basic food supply. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have all kinds of problems. There's a 40% incidence of stunting. Stunting is the lack of cerebral development in children, and it's primarily because of malnutrition and also because of iodine deficiency. And there's iodine, the soils are iodine deficient, so the foods that are produced suck the iodine, and then the digestive system of the human body takes out the remaining iodine, so the kids are left. The fact that the water is contaminated, this is something that even the United Nations fails to acknowledge. The fact that the water is contaminated, it means that the children get parasites. So whatever it is they eat, whatever nutrients they take in, the passage that they take through your bodily systems, the parasites get to it first. So it doesn't get whatever it is that very little of it gets to the brain.
Right.
So you have to fix the water, you have to fix the food, you got to fix it all. It's not a specialized process. It's a whole system thing for the whole community.
Right. You were talking to us about the struggles you had explaining to aid agencies the need for iodine. You know, and I think you and I have talked about it, like people have forgotten that in the U.S., the turn of the century, goiter was like a big thing all over the country. And the lack of iodine, and then the iodine was put into salt, which kind of transformed and changed so that goiter almost disappeared from the country.
Yeah.
And you're like people that don't even understand that now.
Well, there's a smugness by international aid agencies about issues like this. It's easy for them to say, well, you would do better if you just spent all the money that we want to give you by buying salt from supermarket salt, which is iodine. Mandated iodine combined. And that's all very well, but when the salt runs out, then they can no longer afford to buy supermarket salt.
Right.
So they have to buy the traditional salts that somebody peddles, which is iodine deficient.
Mm-hmm.
And so you've got the same problem again. And so it has to be sold systemically.
Yeah.
And that's something that's very difficult because international aid is not systemic oriented, you know, it's specialized.
Right.
It's yeah.
Yeah.
Don't get me started on that one.
No, I think it's to underline the blindness of what
yeah.
we do.
Yeah.
It's really, really important. And one of the things you talked to us is like, this is a culture that was under severe civil war for, you said 18 years, right?
12 years.
12 years. But in a sense, they're still recovering. You know, and you were talking about it. You have a generation that suffered through it, and you have a new generation that...
The differences between war and civil war is that wars are fought between one nation or one tribe between another. Civil war means that you lose three generations. You lose the grandfathers, you lose the fathers, you lose the sons. What this means is that the knowledge that's been acquired in building metallurgy, carpentry, all these skills, all of a sudden there's a big hole in that passage of information that passes from father to son. So you get a deficiency factor in so many things,
yeah.
And especially in community building.
Right.
That's just a kickoff. When you've got settlements established in areas where there's no potable water, well, you know,
right.
I mean, you know, and you're dependent on rain-fed agriculture, well, you know, then it's not a good idea that you cut all the trees down and there's no guaranteed rains anymore. There's variabilities in the patterns of rainfall.
Right.
So, you know, it's like you have to come up with some really systemic responses.
Yeah. And you were talking to us about it's probably the toughest conditions you've ever worked in, because remember you and I were just a little while, this is I'm talking to Ali Sharif, and you were talking to me about you really work well with crises, but this is quite a crisis you've stepped into.
I have 33 workers working in the project, over half of them are recovering from HIV. Yeah. Two of them are recovering from tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you know, that's a kickoff.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, so just, you're working with a population that is weakened because of so many things, right?
Yes, yes.
And we think we have this panacea that we think, oh, we do this, without thinking that we really have to build the bodies back up of people before they can really do something, right?
Yes. Because when you work with resettled communities, it means that the structure of the community is not built around a traditional definition. It's not designed where there's the village center and there's the houses and the areas of agriculture. This is an area where the government, in its rush to settle millions of displaced refugees, had to give plots of land. And so it's a dispersed settlement. And so there's no natural design to the right. the village. So we had to strategize very carefully how we could direct the few resources we had available. And so we concentrated on the school, the children. Our obligation was to see that the children, every child gets 1.5 liters of potable water every single day. All the orphans, the majority of whose parents died because of the HIV epidemic, have to get one daily meal that's nutritious and it's protein rich. They also have to have as many medicinal plants, which include the moringa, oleifera, and the Artemisia annua, and any other medicinal plant that we have dumped into the pot. You know, the bodies get it. Basically, the bodies get it. We had to make sure that children get environmental education in every way possible. We have to work to establish a community organization, an independent community-based a CBO, that's competent in managing a bank account, in managing their organizational affairs. Is competent in dialogue with other entities, government and non-governmental entities. We had to work with farmers into introducing a small measure. Everyone is a gardener there in Africa. They don't need experts to tell them how to grow food, but you can add to the information body that they have. And the charcoal that they burned, instead of throwing away the ash, they could put that back in the soil, drip irrigation, basic stuff like this. So we have to work with the whole community simultaneously. It's not a specialized process. It's a simultaneous whole system application.
Mm-hmm. Good.
And we just crossed our fingers hoping something good comes out of the whole thing.
Right. So Margie and I talk about you've got to find the acupuncture points of change.
Yeah.
To really, and that can be a trial and error thing within a culture. And people don't understand that when you come into a place that has so many wants, you need to find those special places that bring the changes, right?
Yeah.
And it's like finding them. And yes. Like talking to you, your years of experience have given you the eyes to look a little deeper.
Yeah.
That most people wouldn't see this quickly.
Well, you know, Wes, you never stop learning. It took me 3 years to figure out that the center of every single reality of rural communities in these poor resource areas is poverty. Mm-hmm. Everything else, mm-hmm. whether it's trafficking, whether it's abuse, whether it's water security, whether it's food security, whatever, poverty is the very center. Everything comes from that understanding that that's the very core. Mm-hmm. You can budge that a little bit, everything else begins to change.
Yeah. And so that's where you are right now,
yes,
right?
Trying to budge that center.
And you've just, you know, and you have to serve. And right now, we're living in a world where the climate is causing radical shifts And that's another layer that we, you know, that affects us humans, right?
Very much so. I'm looking very forward to finally putting all this together within one more year and being able to go to Bill Mollison, putting it in a dossier on the table and said, well, that's that. It's time for another,
yeah,
another job.
Well, you talked to us, you know, you've been doing this alone for many years, like as a person involved, you've had a passion. And I know what that under you kind of miss a lot of the personal things because your passion to do stuff. And as you said, sometimes it's a lonely journey, right?
It's a very, very lonely journey. I was a bachelor for 30 years and I thought I'd made it.
Yeah.
And when I got to Africa, I became so lonely. I became the loneliest man in the world. I finally said, well, what the hell? I can't do this. So I married a local Shangani girl, embarrassingly young, but she has children and extended family, and we now live together as a unit. And that's how I personally dealt with my loneliness.
But yeah, as creatures, we all need love, right?
Love, but you know, the thing is, where I started from, I came out of revolutionary Iran. And when I managed to escape, everything, I left with so much anger in my heart that I went on the wrong path. I don't know how to describe exactly all the things I did, but I could probably describe it as a ne'er-do-well. And nothing was working out for me. And then I met Bill Mollison and I did my permaculture course and it just clicked. Right. It just clicked. And it became so much easier because Bill said, do not disregard anything that you've ever learned in your life. Everything is useful. Just turn it around and make it into something that you can apply usefully. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there was such a gift. No one has ever given me a gift like that. Yeah. That I feel a personal strength and confidence that I can go anywhere in the world and I know I can be a part of the solution.
Yeah.
I just have to be a little bit more humble, a little bit more calm, a little bit more balanced, and I could just fit right in just about anywhere in the world.
You know, you and I years ago tried to launch something called the Permacore. Yeah. Remember that?
Yes.
It was a first try.
Yes.
And I think it's still incubating in my brain.
Yes.
I have never put it away, but I think all your experience and stuff, we really need to have, what we call, you wouldn't call them shock troops of permaculture, but we need the kind of people that will go places that have the training, because we're in a world where there's a lot of extremes happening.
Yes.
And we do need people to have those skill sets like you do to work in crises.
What I've discovered in third world areas, when you have people going to create change.
Yeah.
And I won't define change at this point.
Right.
But it's not enough, what I've learned, it's not enough to teach what it is you have to teach and then go away. Because in those places, there's very little resources to pick whatever it is they've learned and take it forward. So it more often than not, it fritters away, tragically. Mm-hmm. And so what is required is physical presence. Mm-hmm. It needs to have a face associated that's going to be there tomorrow and the day after. And people have to see that. Mm-hmm. That takes training. That takes long-term training. We gave it a shot, a really good shot in Brazil when we established the Ecoversidad program. Mm-hmm. We, for 3 years, we had students from all over Latin America. Every country in Latin America came and they stayed different lengths of period. 9 months in our centers in Brasilia, Pirinopolis. 9 months, 4 months, and 3 months. Those young people are now all over Latin America and they're all coming center stage right now. And they have the confidence of what they learned along with their own university educations, which they took time off to complete. And now I hear from them and now they're all taking on very important jobs. In Manaus, one of my old students has a job full time, has become an honorary sergeant in the Brazilian army, and is part of the Amazonian contingent of Amazonian sergeants that are being sent all over the Amazon to teach rural communities. And the methodology that they've been trained to teach is permaculture.
Wow. Yeah.
They're called sergeants.
Wow.
Permaculture sergeants.
Wow. Well, that'll be funny because this, Margie and I, 2 weeks ago, were in a rich poll called Richmond, and a young man, he's not a young man, he's in his 30s now, but I met him 10 years ago, and you'd really be interested in this. I met him in at a green festival, and he was telling me, he had this shirt on, it said Permaculture Army. And he actually, a group of them, opened up a house and actually got convinced young people, don't go into the army, come and train in the permaculture army. And they had 10 people for a while.
Whoa.
Doing the usual things, you know, the physical exercise, but in the afternoon working on permaculture projects. So this idea is ripe within permaculture, you know, it's just waiting. And I think, you know, we do have the skill set, and we have the young people who have now want a commitment,
yes,
you know, like
yes,
you did.
Yes, yes.
Who, you know, it's surprising because Margie and I are now are at City College in Santa Barbara. We see them starting really young. We see them 18, 19 years old, already starting to get a lot of experience. But we see them 10 years later, and they're just remarkable because these young people don't stop at one thing. They go out and experience and learn, you know, like the permaculture course is just a beginning, as we all know, right?
Yes.
And I think for you, it's just a start, and then it takes you from there.
But it gives you confidence.
Yes.
Gives you confidence.
Right, Margie? Margie and I see that with the young people. Every class we teach, and we teach invisible structures at City College in Santa Barbara, they are just on fire by the time the course ends. And you can see that. And I think it's really important for the young people right now to feel that passion.
Yeah.
Because it's not like there's hasn't been challenges, but this one is a biggie. We're kind of just, the clock is ticking on the environment, and we really need to shift things. But we need all hands on deck, right?
Yep. All hands on deck.
Right. So, so Ali, this is great talking with you. This is Ali Sharif in Brazil. His organization was called PAL. I sat on the board for a while. I was a secretary, so I'm very intimate with all the work of helping run the organization and then the trials and tribulations of getting money. That's always the, and Ali was remarkable in his work. So thank you, Ali, and glad to have you here in Santa Barbara. This is nice to you stopped in and visited. And we're here at Casitas Valley Farm, which is great, another great permaculture center. So thank you, Ali.
Cheers.